Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Conversations with Coaches podcast. I am your host, Kevin, and I have the pleasure of making the acquaintance and the double pleasure of sharing with you Atta Emami. Atta is a trusted friend, father, husband, son, meditator, yoga teacher, and this is my favorite part, frequently swims in the Pacific Ocean 52 weeks a year. Makes me both excited and a little bit jealous. Love that. And in his spare time, in his voluminous spare time, he helps high-performing executives and their teams to thrive through transformational changes they are facing and increase their impact, both individually and collectively. Atta, it is a pleasure to make your acquaintance, and I'm glad I get to spend a little bit of time with you today. So thanks for being here.
Thank you so much, Kevin. It's a pleasure to be with you and vibrate this energy of yours. I appreciate it.
That's one thing I often in my life over the years and the decades have gotten in my own way, as one might say. And one of the things I realized about, especially this podcast, but most of the things I care about, if I just let my energy come through, like if I'm excited to meet somebody, just be excited. If my hand starts talking and my shoulders start shimmying and my hair starts wobbling because I'm nodding so vigorously, let it happen.
Awesome.
Yeah. Well, let's take us back to the beginning, not the beginning, not all the way back to, like, you know, when you were born and all that stuff, but let's go back to your birth as a coach. What was, and this kind of happens differently for all sorts of different people, but there's always these similar touch points. Who gave you the right words at the right moment? How did you discover that coaching might be either something you were already doing and didn't have the word for it, or something that you realized was the exact way you wanted to impact the world and make a difference in people's lives? How did you come to that coaching moment?
That's a great question. So a long time ago, in a far, far galaxy away, in 2006, 2007, while I had a real job, I tell people jokingly, and I was a leader, I wanted to amplify my leadership skills. So I went to Queen's School of Business, which is the number one business school in Canada. Free shout out to them. And halfway through that program, I was having some struggles with staying in the program for all sorts of different reasons. And I had breakfast with this gentleman named Peter Jensen, Dr. Peter Jensen, which I think I need to give him a shout out and actually let him know I'm doing this. Hopefully maybe he'll hear this. He was coaching Team Canada women hockey team as their executive coach. He's a high performance sports psychology PhD. He's like a really cool dude. And that breakfast, this light bulb for me went on, Kevin, that I'm really interested in the people side of leadership, and I dedicated my life since then to the human development, adult development, and seeing, because what clicked for me when I was talking to him, that he does something with these high-performing athletes that have to perform in front of thousands of people and millions around the world. So whatever I do with the executive teams or the leaders that I worked with back in the time in the financial sector in Canada would be like, the stress level is not even nearly enough. But I realize how when your body and mind is connected and how you study and understand how humans work. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm in. And that really oriented me toward, the people side of leadership. And the rest is history.
I really like that phrase, because I mean, it really gets at something that I've frequently found to be like the really like not so secret heart of what makes coaching so effective and so special, is that there is, and this is something I'll speak personally, but this is something I've seen in myself and in others, this tendency, or at least a particular maybe old habit of thinking of leadership as conceptual. Like, I'm going to read these books on leadership, and I'm going to watch these talks on leadership, and I'm going to learn about leadership. And the people side of it is really, like, honestly, for me, it's really become where the real life is, where the real spark is, because it's where all of that learning and all of that conceptual understanding and all of that like emotional internal life hits the ground and meets other people. It's where it bumps into and meets and interacts with other people. That's where the magic of real leadership happens. And that's where our attention, I feel like, should be. Obviously, there's space for all the learning and all the books. I mean, we both have bookshelves in our Zoom backgrounds. And there's definitely a place for that. But I personally, I love the emphasis, not just the like name checking, but the focus on the people side of leadership. I really like that phrase a lot. I'm gonna borrow that if you don't mind.
Please, it's not even mine. I'm sure it just came up from this conversation, and I plus point to everything you said, Kevin. I'm a big fan, and It just, I realized to your point, I have like many examples. I don't want to bore you with it, but I still like kept my job for a few years, like a real job. But like I would walk into like these complex programs and projects that, you know, fire three project managers, everybody struggling. And all those people were far better than me in terms of their project management hard skills or, you know, like a technical skills. And I'm like, I read the room. I look at the people back then. It wasn't mostly in the Zoom. It was all physical in the boardroom. I'm like, oh, this group and that group, they're not really talking to each other. I'm just leaning into the why of it. You know, I love this metaphor I learned from Bill or William Ury, the co-author of the book, Getting to Yes. It's like this, he's like one of the masterful negotiators that in my life. I learned a lot from him. It's like, you know, having people sitting around a metaphoric campfire and committing to stay there until we resolve our issues. That's what I thrive to see when I work with teams. And I've seen it so many times that it's possible when there people are willing and, you know, everything else comes, the techniques, every, you know, things I need to learn. As long as they're willing to show up and stay there in the uncomfortableness of that, you know, like a sitting around a campfire, it's just the magic happens, to your point. It's just beautiful to be participating in it.
I think you very smartly identified too. It's that initial uncomfortableness of coming together. Like I think often about how, especially as organizations grow and really find great success, there's a natural tendency for departments to form, or, you know, I know silo can have a negative terminology, but people, you know, they're very, 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 very good at what they do and how that contributes to the success of the organization. So obviously a lot of their skill development, a lot of their attention, a lot of their comfort is there. And then, I mean, you're all part of the same body. You're all organs and limbs and a part of the same whole. But whenever you have to interact, or whenever you have to bump up against the needs or the skills or the desires of those other parts of the organization, there's not nearly as much attention paid there. And that can feel a little bit uncomfortable. Again, the skills are there to be developed. The campfires are to be gathered around. Coaches like you are there to guide and coax and teach these skills and this inclination. But there's that little initial discomfort, that uncomfortableness sitting around that fire. And if you can just get over that hurdle of that sort of that new, different uncomfortableness and not just retreat to your own private campfire or your own little silo or your own comfort space. If you can stay in that uncomfortable moment for a while, and this is where you come in so beautifully as a coach, holding people, not holding them to the fire, but holding them around the fire, so to speak, and just let that uncomfortability sit there for a while. So much magic, so much bridge building, so much connectivity begins to occur naturally. And from there, it's just a matter of working with it, you know, teaching the skills, bringing attention to it. And then before you know it, your little small team, your little isolated teams have become much more aware and a part of the whole. And I find it very magical. I love I get very romantic about it because I feel like it really is. You see that light dawning on their faces, that like light bulb moment, or light bulb seems too small. It's really like a sunrise moment where it's like, oh, I didn't realize it could be this beautiful and this bright and this warm here on this other side of the beach.
Exactly. Yeah. I love the metaphor you're using. It's the sunrise moment. Yeah. It starts with that willingness to sit around that metaphoric campfire. Yeah.
Well, let's talk a little bit about like the nuts and bolts of how you facilitate that, how you guide that, how you get that done. And I like to ask this question kind of as a two-parter because I feel like it gets at the real heart of someone's coaching practice. So at least these days, who do you coach and how do you coach them? The who is if there's any particular demographic or industry or location on a corporate ladder, so to speak. Like basically like the, how you would define the who you focus on coaching, who you focus on impacting these days in your practice. And the how is basically your preferred techniques. And sometimes it's all of the above, but you've got your one-to-one coaching where it's just you and one other person in a room. That's obviously where so many coaches get their start and where so much of that magic still happens. There's group coaching, there's team coaching, there's interdepartmental, there's, you know, C-suite executive coaching, there's coursework, there's keynote speeches. So who do you coach and how do you coach them? And I know that's a gigantic question. So pick your favorites and let's talk about that for a few minutes.
you nail it, Kevin. And I have to say, like a few months ago, I hired a business person and I made this poor person so frustrating because I do all those things you just mentioned. So in a broad stroke, if you, and I would look for you to guide me for the time. It's good portion of the people I coach are in the very fast-paced tech sector. I also work with executives in like the energy sector, and very small, which I, but a special place in my heart with paramilitary groups, because, I mean, these are like police forces who run in one state and one province, North America, and just the impact these people have in the lives of human beings and their societies and communities. They have their place, a special place in my heart working with them. As a special privilege for me to work with them. But I work with right now, well, like in this tech sector, which is majority work with one, like a C-level suit and a lot of SLTs, a lot of senior leadership teams. So basically the senior leadership teams who work with the executive teams. And I honestly thrive in both ends. So I do one-on-one and one-to-many. I'm a big fan, converted, I don't know, over half, like, 2013, I started a journey of organizational change to being first as one of my mentors, Dean Anderson, who he does like change at the level that, you know, like is to me was jaw dropping back then. Still 10 years later, still maybe I'm a slow student, Dean. but it just fascinates me. Even you see the layers of system, intricacies of the system, and what I call like a force multiplier. When you help an SLT and the leaders between them till the front line. And I've had a personal experience of working with a team of like 5,000 people over the course of years, and their results collectively catapulted. And a lot of it was volunteer work. I wasn't asked by the SLT to work with the mid levels and the front line, but that gave me so much background context of, hey, why, where the, you know, telephone line is broken down. You know, this is the SLT so much caring, and this they're saying A, and in the front line, they're hearing Z. I'm like, that's not what they're saying. So there's a lot of stuff. And personally, puts me in my edge of development, meaning, you know, like you have to show up in a lot of unknown territories when you're doing work with groups of people, preparing keynotes. I have one that I have to prepare. I can't even see the audience anymore. It's just like videographers and, you know, green room and all these things. And I was like, you know, like the calm yourself down and then be present. But multiplier factor of team coaching, I became a fan about 10 years ago, seeing it, witnessed it, and I've been doing it actively since then. It was wobbly, and I hope it's less wobbly. That's why they hire me still. So knock on wood. But yeah, I love that aspect of it. And the one-on-one, when you go deep with an executive who has in charge of thousands of people, or in the paramilitary group, they call them executive command teams. Like you're working with an executive command team member who's like, you know, half of, a state, you know, all the troops and everybody work with them. It just, I find it quite exciting and, you know, quite humbling to work with them.
Yeah. And I think you're so spot on to identify that as a force multiplier, because you really are, like when you're coaching a senior leadership team, or when you're coaching a CEO or an executive, or when you're coaching someone who's responsible for, you know, half of a province's, you know, enforcement force, you are essentially coaching the dozens and hundreds and sometimes thousands of people that they have a direct effect on a regular basis, sometimes daily, sometimes hourly. And being able to, and I love that you have, as a natural outgrowth of your coaching, has sometimes taken you down into what you might call the infrastructure, where it's like you're going down the quote unquote ladder and seeing where the communication breakdowns might be. And I love that you identified that almost like a game of telephone, where it's like there's A is being said here and A is being understood here, but B, C, and D, and E, and sometimes Z are what's actually coming out of the mouths of these people over here. Where's the disconnect? And you begin to learn about the identity and the positioning of those senior leaders as you begin to understand what's being said and what's happening in the organization and what's actually making its way up to them in the flow of information. And it gives you such a deeper insight. It really does. I love that was a natural outgrowth, and how you really are just like, you know, I might still feel wobbly sometimes when I'm trying to coach these senior leadership teams, but honestly, and this might be a little bit too cutesy for you, but for me, like what starts out as a wobble with time and training and commitment and passion becomes a dance. It might not feel like you're dancing, but you will acquire a grace that allows you to truly dance and move with people and make the kind of difference you're clearly making.
Thank you. You're super kind, partly because you don't know me well, Kevin, but to your point, you know, like I remember, like, you know, like, literally this like 10,000 hour thing, you know, literally like hundreds of hours of being in, like, you know, with amazingly wonderful, talented mentors and work with them. And I, you know, like a few months ago, I prepared something for a 2-day workshop with like an executive team. You're basically putting ton of hours and you walk in and half an hour in, you have to basically throw your whole agenda and prep work away and work with what's in the room, because the room wants to go somewhere else, even though you work with the chief of staff, you work with people behind, you know, they said this is where they want to go, but something pops into the awareness of, oh, this is where the energy is. And you just have to trust that you have enough that you can navigate the wobbliness of, instead of, but I prepared all these things for you. I'm like, who cares? You know, in service of the people in the room, you just have to be willing, and makes it way harder than doing one-on-one coaching with one person.
Yeah. Again, you nailed it again, in service of the people who are in that room. And I love, that's something that I find with all good coaches have this in common, is that they have their plans. They do their research. They do the hard work. They put in the hours, and they will go where their clients need them to go. They will guide where their clients need guidance. And I feel like that to me is one of the identifying markers, the key identifiers of a truly good coach. And so that you just said that naturally. Again, I don't know you. I'm giving you the rosiest possible interpretation, but from what I've seen and what I've gotten to know over these few minutes and what I've, like, you know, read about you here and there and everywhere, you're the real deal. So thank you for expressing yourself so succinctly and so clearly. And thank you for doing what you do. I like your approach, and I like your commitment to it. It's clearly a point of passion for you. And that shows, which means something, I know, to me, and I'm sure it means something to your clients.
Thank you. You've said something that is like really like a big thing in my heart a few times, as if you really know me well, Kevin. I think you do. It's like, it's important to me to be of service more than the, you know, the coaching contract and everything else. Like and it aligned with the vows I make every morning. When I'm in service, it like keeps me going. So I have friends who I dearly love. And I'm an introvert too. I was going to say, maybe because they're introvert, like we do like this, like a day long session with them, and they have to take like a week off. I thrive on it. I feel energized, you know, after, because I feel like, oh, I was in service to these, you know, wonderful, caring human beings who down the line, the telephone line, they've been not perceived as caring as they are, especially because of all the rapid changes in the tech sector, you know, like generative AI, all these other things. People forget that, you know, they're human beings who really care. And participating in that with them is like quite a gift.
That's the perfect word. It is a beautiful gift. So speaking of gifts, I would love to just selfishly keep you as my gift, but I got to get you out of here. So before I let you go, where can, if people just want to learn more about you, who you are, what you do, what you've done, what you stand for, just learn more, where can they best go? Like, you know, LinkedIn, a website, et cetera. And if they want to connect with you, what's the best way for them to do that?
Yeah, thank you again. I'm embarrassed to say my website has been under construction for a long time now. changefacilitators.com. But the LinkedIn is the best place. People can find me on LinkedIn. I hold office hours for a particular company's alumni right now. Every Friday at noon EST. However, I respond to almost every single request, the DM, you know. I feel like sometimes there are more people wanting to solve problems for coaches that are coaches out there in LinkedIn, but this is my cynical view. But other than those, I respond to, I because it makes me to be of service. So, yeah.
Well, all right, LinkedIn profile. I'll make sure there's a link to your LinkedIn profile in the show notes with your name correctly spelled, all that. I don't want to lose anybody in the search bar.
Thank you so much for what you're doing, Kevin. I really appreciated our conversations.
It's my pleasure. And yeah, I'd love to have you back on. I feel like it went by so fast. I mean, I know we weren't talking very long.
Yes.
Dubai. I feel like I could do this again and for longer. So don't be surprised if I direct message you on LinkedIn or find you on your website whenever it's, you know, eventually constructed. Because I would love to talk to you again soon. Thank you so much for
your
time.
My pleasure. My pleasure, Kevin. Yeah.
And to the audience, know what to do next. Like if you've gotten the same warmth from this conversation that I have, even a fraction of it, connect with Atta on LinkedIn. Just learn more about him. Just connect. He has warm presence and he has a lot to offer. So I just want to encourage you, the audience, to do that. And we here at the podcast, we'll get to talk to you again very, very soon.
Thank you so much to you and your team, Kevin. Appreciate you all.